To kick off the course, I'm sure many of you are already asking, why should I care about privacy and security? I have nothing to hide. And that's a great question. First, to quote Mikko Hipponen, I hope I pronounced that correctly, a computer security expert, you might not have anything to hide, but you have everything to protect. Why is this? What does he mean? Let's break it down. Thank you so much in advance for watching the free course, but if you do want quizzes, checklists, certificates, and no ads, that's the best one, make sure to check out the premium version. You can find more information on how to access this on my website, techlore.tech. Hope to see you there and have fun with the rest of this lesson. First, not only is privacy from law something in the US Constitution, but privacy is recognized as a fundamental human right in the 1948 United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The problem is that privacy is ending. It is a crisis. Your home address, your phone number, your social security number, your bank accounts, credit history, shopping address, work history, travel habits, and anything else about your life is information that is readily available to anyone who might be interested in them. The internet has created an environment that makes it easier than ever for people to harvest your information, and this can impact you in many ways. Market manipulation leads to marketers bombarding your phone and email, which they purchase from other companies. This can be from your bank, like US Bancorp in Minnesota, social media like Facebook, which goes through at least one privacy scandal every year, or even medical records, which can be sold even though they are meant to be confidential. Credit card fraud will cause a headache for days, weeks, or even months, and the culprit is typically poor privacy and security with your credit card information. Companies want to convince you there is no way to protect yourself so that they can sell a product to do it for you. I will teach you otherwise. Identity theft allows people to commit crimes under your name, which can permanently affect your life. You do not need LifeLock to do this for you, as we'll see later in the course. Stalking is potentially harmful as well. Not only can this be in the form of harassment, but it can lead to violence or, in rare cases, sometimes death. Technology has enabled stalkers to track their victims more efficiently and more accurately than ever before. I would read about Amy Boyer if you haven't already. Last but not least, there's government surveillance. The NSA developed Echelon, a spy network that monitors communication around the world. FinCEN retrieves personal financial information in real time. XKeyscore instantly wiretaps someone's online conversations by only knowing their email. Fascia allows them to track cell phones worldwide. Optic Nerve stole almost 2 million private Yahoo images. And Prism allows the NSA to tap into personal, private data in tech companies like Facebook, Google, and Apple. This is all surface level and still crazy to hear about. There are hundreds of these programs. The government is increasingly tracking the movements of innocent citizens and doing so as a matter of policy, not as a result of a warrant and reasonable suspicion. Any opposition to this is greeted by the response that if a person is doing anything wrong, they should have nothing to hide. We are losing privacy to the government, and in the process, we are falling under its control. Glenn Greenwald discusses this issue in his TED Talk, where he exposes concerns behind nonstop surveillance. I recommend all of you watch this. It is phenomenal. One of my favorite quotes on the topic is by Edward Snowden, when he said, "Arguing that you don't care about the right to privacy because you have nothing to hide is no different than saying you don't care about free speech because you have nothing to say." Many will argue that the NSA is keeping us safe, but has the NSA actually kept us more secure? Is there at least some benefit? Well, the evidence says no. In 2013, a group analyzed terrorism cases involving the NSA's bulk collection of phone records and found they were completely non-essential to preventing terrorist attacks. In 2014, another report echoed these conclusions, saying that traditional investigative methods like tips from communities and intelligence operations have been much more effective than the NSA's bulk surveillance. The NSA claimed in 2013 they stopped more than over 50 terrorist attacks, but this list remains classified, which means we have no actual evidence or proof of its validity. The NSA did discuss 4 cases in public, and just one where surveillance made a large impact. This involved a San Diego taxi driver who sent money to a terrorist organization, but even the details for this case are murky. In 2015, they have admitted to never stopping any terrorist attacks that might have been large. The Mass Telephone Records Collection Program, aka Section 215, was revealed to have no instance in which the NSA could say with confidence that the outcome of a terrorist investigation would have been any different. We were even told that the NSA sends tips to the FBI about suspicious phone numbers and email addresses so that the FBI can pursue those leads. However, I quote, "The tips were so frequent and such a waste of time that the field officers reported back in frustration, 'You're sending us garbage.'" So I would like to ask you, the viewer, is tracking every digital communication necessary to the security of our nation or any other nation? I would argue there's not enough evidence to say there is. Mass surveillance is scary because it can be used as a tool to silence citizens, similar to the novel 1984 by George Orwell. We're already starting to see invasive mass surveillance in countries like China. I know for a fact that you who is watching this lesson acts differently in your office when there are people watching you than when your office is empty. This is the same idea as you being able to express your true self in society. We can't live in a true democracy if we are constantly being surveyed to ensure we are being proper citizens in the eyes of those in power. In fact, you can already see the silencing of citizens take place today. In the United States, people who expose fraudulent activities in companies, also known as whistleblowers, are encouraged and are protected by laws in many states in order to hold companies accountable and prevent them from abusing their power. But do we have a similar program like this for governments, which allows citizens to hold our governments accountable? Well, no. If somebody exposes an NSA document showing our 2016 election included hacks by Russian intelligence, they would be breaking the law, even though this should be made public to the people, and the act of making the hack publicly known won't endanger our security any more than it already has. Well, this actually happened. Reality Winner did expose NSA documents showing this to be the case, and Winner was recently sentenced to prison. Terry Albury was a former counterterrorism agent at the FBI who shared classified documents to the media in an effort to reveal how the Bureau treated minority communities unfairly. He was sentenced up to 10 years in prison. And of course, the all-famous Edward Snowden exposed programs that the NSA was implementing to spy on its citizens without them being aware. We would still not know these programs exist today if these documents hadn't been leaked by Snowden. If you want to learn more about Snowden and the reasoning behind everything he did, I would recommend watching the Vice documentary on YouTube. It is phenomenal. To summarize, you need to protect your data. It holds the key to your pictures and contacts, the money in your bank, all of your personal information, and all of your private communication. You're not going to be sharing this data with strangers on the street, and just because digital strangers are collecting it without your knowledge doesn't mean it shouldn't still be a concern. We need to normalize privacy and implement better security in our world. I hope I've made my case, and I hope to see more people begin to take their privacy and security seriously. I will see you in the next lesson on security versus privacy, and do not forget to normalize privacy. See you soon.